of power because we are kings and our words matter. How and why God makes us wealthy, why God wants us to have the blessing of Abraham, and why God wants us to prosper financially. Why? Because every family in this earth shall hear the gospel.
My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is. Oh my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will.
Job 22, let me read to you from verse 21 onwards. Now acquaint yourself with him and be at peace. Here is a good advice a man is giving. He said, get to know God and be at peace. The main preoccupation in your life is to get to know God. Do you know God? Acquaint yourself with him and be at peace. In Tamil, it comes out very beautifully. Acquaint yourself with him and good things will happen to you. You get to know him, you'll have good coming your way. Because he's the one that is the source of all good. He's the fountainhead of all that is good that is produced. So acquaint yourself with him, then good will flow your way. How true it is. Then listen to this. Receive, please, instruction from his mouth. And lay up his words in your heart. See how this man gives advice. Get to know God. And then receive his word from his mouth. And lay it up, lay his words in your heart. Why? Why he says that? What will happen if you acquaint yourself with God and lay up his words that comes out of his mouth in your heart and guard it in your heart, like Proverbs 4 says? Let it not depart out of your mouth. Let it not depart out of your eyes. Like the word of God says it so many places. What is the use of putting the word in the heart? Listen to verse 24. Then you will lay your gold in the dust and the gold of Ophir among the stones of the brooks. Literally saying, you will lay up gold like dust and gold like the stones of Ophir. In other words, you will lay up gold like dust and these gold biscuits or whatever they call them, like stones of a river bank, you will lay them up. That's what he's saying actually. It'll be just like stones. Now somebody, you know, I remember, you know, some very educated people sometimes, you know, they come up with all kinds of ideas, educated in the Bible or theology, you know, sometimes. They say, well, you got to read the Bible with a little, you know, must be very careful. Don't get carried away by this, because a lot of things are poetically given there. It's good for poetry, but not real. Now, I consider that too, because they may be true, but I found they're wrong. It is not poetically given, it's really given. Consider David. He was a shepherd boy who was taking care of a few sheep. God chose him to be a king and exalted him and elevated him. And that guy, the greatest desire he had was that he must build a house for the Lord. He had a beautiful cedar home built of cedar wood, most expensive, most beautiful wood. But he just couldn't, you know, think of him having such a good home, but the Lord, he wanted to have a good house for the Lord where people can come together and gather. People can hear the word of God. People can grow in the knowledge of God and start to love God more and be built up together. So he decided that he'll build a great house for the Lord, and not an ordinary thing, a house that people will just come to look at it because it'll be a showpiece in the whole world. Just build it enormously and it'll be a display of glorious wealth that God has given him and blessed him with. So the Bible says, if you know about the Dake's Bible, if you read that portion where David gave a donation to build the house of the Lord, he personally gave some hundreds of crores worth of rupees in that day as donation to build the house of the Lord. And everybody that was working under him, the lords and the big leaders of the nation of Israel, they all started to give, and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of crores were gathered. And then he calls his son on top of that. He says, here is all this money. I have not been able to build it, but in your time, you build it. And remember, I've got all this. You don't need any money or anything. We got all, if all the money is there. All the gold and silver is there. You know, so I've given so much. Others have given so much. The people have given so much. But on top of that, he says, I have gold and silver and precious stones and all kinds of precious wood and material that is needed for the building of the house of the Lord. Unaccounted, totally uncounted. No time to count, he says. I've got heaps and heaps of them. No time to count how much I've got. No time to count the gold. Now, does it look like a shepherd boy talking? In one lifetime, just starting out as a little shepherd boy, dealing with just a few sheep, he rose to become one of the wealthiest men in the world, possessing so much riches. And the desire of his heart is that he must take all of this wealth and bestow it upon the purpose of building a great temple for God. Great house for God, for God's glory. I tell you, no wonder God blessed that shepherd boy so much. His desire is not that he could have a nice house or he can have a great future and a pension plan. His desire is that a glorious house for God must be built, and it must be a display of God's glory and the glorious wealth that God had given him. And for that, he never spared anything. Everything he had, he puts into it, and he doesn't even think anything about it. Everything belongs to the Lord. Amazing. He prays that prayer where he says, Lord, we didn't bring anything. Everything came from you. See, he's got a man who's got head on his shoulder. He's thinking the right way. He knows the right perspective in life. Everything came from you, so we give to you. Who are we to give to you? We didn't make anything. We didn't invent anything. Everything came from you, so we give to you, he says. It's all from you. We're just returning to you out of what you have given so abundantly. So, listen to this. Verse 24. Then you will lay up gold in the dust and the gold of Ophir among the stones of brooks, of the brooks. Like dust you will have gold, and like the stones of the brooks you will have gold. Yes, the Almighty will be your gold and your precious silver. Yet, the Almighty God will be your gold and precious silver. You see, you will not be going after gold and you will not be just delighting in gold and loving gold and silver. God will be your gold and silver, but you'll have gold and silver. You see, God doesn't care how much gold you got and how much silver you got, how much money you got. One fellow said, well, brother, you shouldn't have that much money because, oh, that's what you call filthy rich, you know. Even God doesn't like anybody having that much money. Well, God doesn't care how much money you got because he's got much more than what you got and what you can even imagine. God is not just a petty person, you see. God made everything. God doesn't care about how much he got. God cares about what is in your heart, you see. And for this man, he says, God will be your gold and silver. Your love will be towards God. Now listen to this, a wonderful passage. Verse 26, for then you'll have your delight in the Almighty and lift up your face to God. Now this is talking about how things are going to work out in this person's life. Now he's got hooked up to God, got to know God personally, and now put his word in his heart, and therefore he's prospering materially, gold like dust, and like the stones of the brooks he's gathering. Gold is nothing to him, it's all coming to him, everything is working out to him. And so now, then you will have your delight in the Almighty and lift up your face to God, and you will make your prayer to him, and he'll hear you, and you'll pay your vows. What is he talking about? He's talking about how when you're hooked up to God and God is word in your heart, how things are going to be for you. Then you'll make a prayer and God is so pleased with you to grant you whatever you desire. Because he likes your steps. He likes the way you live. He likes your philosophy of life. He likes the perspective that you have. He likes this good man. He likes this man that lives for God and loves God and uses money. God loves this fellow. And you lift up your face to God in prayer. What will happen in prayer? Listen to this. He will hear you and you'll pay your vows. Vows does not really mean religious vows like, you know, people say, well, I've pledged 1,000 rupees, so I'm going to give this 1,000 rupees. See, that is one little part of it. That's not everything. When it's talking about how you'll pay your vows as a result of God answering prayers, it means much more than that. Not just the vows that you made to give to God here and there and so on that you must do. But the thing is, it means much more than that. When you bought your house, you made a vow to the bank. Because you borrowed money from the bank, you made a vow saying, I will pay every month so much. And you signed on the dotted line. When you bought your car, you made a vow and signed. Said, next 3 years, I'll pay this much every month for my car. When you bought other things, you probably signed for it too. So you got a lot of vows you made. It's talking about vows. It's not just the one vow you made in the church or something like that. It's talking about the vows of your life. That means your obligations, your monthly obligations. He says you lift up your face to God in prayer and he will hear you and answer you, and you will be able to make your payments on time. Now that makes you understand it very clearly, right? You got an amen from that. See how it goes into people, you know, I like that. You'll make your payments on time. You don't have to be begging for it. You don't have to be worrying about it. You don't have to be worried about it. You don't have to be fretting about it. You don't have to worry about where it's going to come from. Because you're so hooked up to God, you got the word in your heart, and you're living for God. Gold and silver just comes your way. Everything that you do prospers. And when you lift up your face to God and pray, he answers you, and you will be able to make your payments on time. All your vows can be paid. If you pledge something somewhere, you can pay it. Isn't that something? Hello? Some people are thinking, my God, this is a new kind of sermon here. You know, sometimes I'm so amazed, you know, the way that we go, you know. We'll sell anything from vada to medu pokada to biryani to raise some funds, you know. We call it a sale for the missionaries. And we sell all of these things to raise some 50,000 rupees or 1 lakh rupees to give to some missionary somewhere. And that's never enough, you know. This is nothing, you know. And everybody says, oh, that's a wonderful church. They had a sale. And we raised 50,000 rupees by selling good for nothing biryani that nobody can eat. And vada. And all of these things that people bought just so that they can give to that missionary. And they say, that's wonderful. But I am preaching this as a, he's not so wonderful. He's talking about riches. He's talking about prosperity. I am telling you, my friend, if we preach about this in every church, no church will be lacking in anything. Hallelujah. No church will lack in anything. We don't have to have a big, thing to raise some funds or anything like that. Funds will be there because everybody, you know, will now understand why God blesses them, why God prospers them, and they'll use their money for why God has given them money for in the first place. I heard about a meeting where they'd invited all these young people and they said, 300 rupees for 3 days, you come to this hill station, we're going to have a retreat. Don't miss it. It's going to be a great, great blessing for you. Don't miss it. And all these young people went there. After 3 days, they found there was 5,000 rupees short. They'd spent 5,000 rupees more than their, planned expenses. So the preacher in the last day shut all the doors and said, nobody can go out. We are 5,000 rupees short. We are 5,000 rupees short. How can you go home today? This young kid said, my God, you know, man, I paid 300 rupees to get here. You told me it'd be a great blessing, so I came. How can you go home today? If you have a watch, throw it in the offering box. If you got a chain, throw it in the offering box. If you got this, throw it there. How can you go home without meeting this need? Before we leave this place, I must know that we've got the 5,000 rupees. Now, if I was the young man, then I'd have said, who told you to have this meeting, brother? We didn't want the meeting. You had the meeting and you invited us and you told us it'll cost 300 rupees. If you told us in the first place that it'll cost 500 rupees, you'd have paid the 500 and got here. Why you get us here for 300 rupees and then tell us you're running short? Now, all that is okay. If you're like that, they'll say, oh, good preacher, we have a wonderful man of God. He ran 5,000 rupees short. We shut all the doors and we locked everybody in. And got the money that day. Praise God, we got the money. I tell you, if you had enough money, you can simply say, you go home, we'll take care of the 5,000 rupees. 5,000 rupees is nothing. If it's 5,000 rupees or 50,000 rupees, we'll take care of it. God is good. God is gracious. God has given us more than enough. We'll take care of it. You see, this will solve a lot of problems in a lot of churches. A lot of churches suffer without money. A lot of, and missionary work and all kinds of other work, good causes for which we must give, it will not suffer, you see. It will not suffer. We can do anything for God if there was enough money. You see, we can do what God wants us to do. One person was complaining so much. I turned the television on. They're asking for money. I said, brother, they need money to run that thing. You're sitting there happily enjoying the thing whole day. Have you ever given anything? Hello? Have you ever given anything? Well, brother, I like the preaching so much. I like the whole thing so much from morning till night. I have it on. All right, you have it on from morning till night. You like all the spiritual content, the powerful anointed messages and all the thing that comes through this television. But did you ever write to them and say, here is my thing. I'm going to give you this much. They say, but see, brother, I'm on a limited income, brother. That is why I'm not able to give so much. But I enjoy the TV so much. But I don't like them asking for money. Well, if you had so much money, then they don't have to ask for money because they'll have so much money also. Why there is a shortage? You know, because you know, everybody's running on a very short string. Everybody's got only so much and no more, and they can't give, and you know, they're themselves having a lot of trouble. That's what I'm preaching about, my friend. I'm preaching about the fact of how and why God makes us wealthy, why God wants us to have the blessing of Abraham, and why God wants us to prosper financially. Why? Because every family in this earth shall hear the gospel. And you and I are going to make it possible. We'll make it possible. If everybody had money, you know. You don't have to sell vada and biryani, you know. You just write a check. You say, how much are you going to raise? Cancel the sale. I'll write the check for 1 lakh. Here it is. Finished. It's because the minds are too small. It has not accommodated God's plans and purposes. We don't think in those high levels, you know. Let me read on. You'll also declare a thing. This is the verse I want to close with. You'll also declare a thing, and it'll be established for you. So light will shine on your ways. You will also declare a thing. Declare a thing. It says this. You will also declare a thing. That means you will decide and you will declare. See, all the time, when you are not empowered and blessed, when you don't have enough, everybody else decides your fortune. All your relatives come together and say, no, don't buy that because you can't have it. You can't have a house like that. You can't have a car like that. Don't buy it. Why they're talking like that? Because you don't have. You're not empowered. They'll all put a circle around you and say, this is it and no more. Don't go beyond this. This is all you can get. So suppose you want to buy a house. Not only the relatives are putting drawing the line, the banker also comes. He's got a program called pre-qualifying thing, you know, the pre-qualifiers. So he'll come with his notebook and say, what is your last 3 years income? Let me see the return and everything, calculate everything, how much you can pay. He says, this is what we can give you. We can give you 20 lakhs, no more. So find a house under that. So when he does the pre-qualifying thing, then we get the preset in our mind. You see, whatever he said, that sets on very well because we are not so much into the world. Christians are not so much into the world. So when the pre-qualifier comes and qualifies us for so much loan, we say, well, if that's all I'm qualified for, then that's all I'm going to get. But I tell you, the name of Jesus qualifies you for a lot more. Amen. Hello. Don't, you know, you should not be in a position where somebody else is deciding your fortune and telling you what you can have and what you cannot have. It shall be according to your faith. Where is your faith? Are you not having anything in your heart? Don't you look at the word of God? Don't you believe anything? What have you decided? Don't you make any decisions based on what you believe and what you expect out of your faith? Don't let somebody decree and decide for you. You decide according to the faith that is in your heart. That's why you need to put the word of God in your heart and grow day by day in the knowledge of God's faithfulness so that on the basis of that, on the basis of your faith that you now have, you can decide what you want.
I know who I am. I know who I am. I know who I am. I am yours. I am yours. I know who I am. I know who I am. your friend. I am accepted. I know who I am.
Make this confession.
I am secure. I'm confident.